Let us pray. Lord of abundant riches, when asked to give everything to follow Jesus, a rich man faltered. Give us the courage to give everything that we have to you, knowing that what you offer is more valuable than all the riches in the world. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. For those of you gathered, take a moment to share a greeting or a sign of peace. Those of you online, please share a word of peace in the chat or comment. And most of all, as we go out into the world, let us greet all as people of peace.
The reading today is from Romans chapter 8, lines 14 through 21. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, for you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. But you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God, for the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I want you to stand for the reading of the gospel from Mark, the 10th chapter. People were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him, and he asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." The rich man said to him, "Teacher, I've kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. And then Jesus looked around and said to the disciples, How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" And Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to them, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." And Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now and in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last shall be first." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, grace and peace to you from God and our Savior Jesus. Amen. We are continuing our narrative lectionary, walking through the gospel of Mark. We started in January with his baptism, and we are now in the season of Lent after the transfiguration that Jesus is going toward Jerusalem. And that's what all of these stories are going to be between now and then. Today's reading is similar to our Ash Wednesday reading. We read about Jesus lifting up a child to illustrate how countercultural it is to be a follower of Jesus. A child was worthless in that society. But Jesus instructed the disciples to welcome children. And if they did so, for one child in Jesus' name, they not only welcomed Jesus, but also the one who sent Jesus, God. Word must have spread because now people were bringing their children to Jesus as he was teaching throughout the lands. But what did the disciples do? The disciples were like, "Keep them quiet. Don't disturb the master. He's teaching." And what does Jesus do? He says, "Let the children come to me." And then he gives this statement, "No one will enter the kingdom of God unless they enter it like a child." It made no sense in that society. Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. Jesus will continue to point out how dangerous it is setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. The Lent season is all about discipleship, learning to set your mind on divine things, and that is hard to learn and harder to live. Something considered a divine thing is memorizing a Bible verse, right? How many of us know John 3:16? Can we say it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus said to be born again one time, to one person, in one gospel, in secret, in the dark of night. And we accept that as a mandate for all believers. Here's the next one. For those who did not hear my message last service, you ruin it for others. So do not do that. But has anyone memorized prior to 8:30 or looking at the verses, Mark 21, Matthew 19, 21, Luke 18, 22? Jesus said, sell everything and give it to the poor. One time to one person, but in public, after he had encouraged the crowds to come. And it's recorded in three Gospels, Mark, Matthew, and Luke. We believe and hold others to the account of the first statement, God so loved the world. But we dismiss, make excuses, and even justify not following the second, even though Jesus said it. And it was recorded three times in public to everyone. This line of argument was made by Rich Mullins. Funny that his name is Rich. I think God has a great sense of humor. He was an American contemporary Christian songwriter and singer, with his most famous song being Awesome God. How many of you know that? I was going to challenge Pat to do it at the first service, and then Greg just did it, which is awesome. It is a favorite for our vacation Bible school. And at his death, Rich Mullins' net worth was around $6 million. But he never knew it. When his career took off, he arranged for his fortune to be managed in a blind trust, with him receiving a modest allowance and his money being used for good elsewhere. In the music industry, he knew full well what money and temptation can do to someone. I've seen firsthand what money and temptation can do to anyone. We see it in our world every day. Navalny, a reckless shooting, petty theft, you name it. All these things that keep us from experiencing the peaceable kingdom that we are called to do. But there are simple ways for us to give a glimpse of heaven on earth. Did you catch Jesus' statement prior to telling the rich man to sell his possessions? What did he say just before that? Well, that was after. Well, that's what he said, follow the commandments. And then he said, before he tells him to sell his possessions, Jesus looked at him. He didn't tell it, I apologize. The writer points out. Jesus looks at the rich man and says, he loved him. He loved him first and foremost. He loved him. Not for what he had done and not for against what he would not do. He simply loved him first and foremost. In all three Gospels, Jesus blessing the children comes prior to this story of the rich man not giving up his possessions. That's intentional. We are first and foremost children of God, whether we know it or not. We are God's children. And in the time of that blessing, in that first century, children had little to no rights, often seen as a nuisance. They were tolerated but not welcomed. And Jesus flipped this way of thinking on its head. What is the greatest position in all of the kingdom? To be children of God. That there is nothing greater we can do. That is why I don't like to be called Pastor Rob, because it senses this hierarchy. Like I'm better than you. I hear that all the time. Can you pray because you're a little closer? No, we're all in this together. And we're all ministers of God, and more importantly, we're all children of God. No one higher, no one lower. I respect you as well, Sue. I you are absolutely right, Minister Sue. I feel like I'm back in my other congregation that I came from where we had conversations back and forth. But you and I, all we're called to do is be on our knees before Christ, regardless of anything, any position that we hold. Let us first and foremost be children of God. And the rich man was all about acquiring possessions. He even thought faith was about acquiring possessions. What must I do to inherit eternal life, he says. He contradicts himself right in that statement. What must I do to inherit eternal life? God's already given it to us in Christ. We are God's children. That's where we receive the inheritance. And Jesus has come to let us know that we are all a part of that. The rich man was about acquiring possessions and looking at faith in that same manner. You don't acquire faith, it's inherited. When that happens, you give everything because of it. And Jesus continued talking about that camel going through the eye of the needle. And there's a lot of conflicting opinions on what that means. There's three pastors in this room. We might not all agree. The various commentaries I had were not in agreement. But if you take the story of the rich man who had many possessions, the opinion is that within the city walls there were doorways that were quite small. And if you had the camel and it was loaded down with possessions, it could not go through the doorway. And so the person needed to leave it behind to enter in. I love that illustration, that image. Just as the rich man was asked to do. Leave your possessions behind and then enter. These are hard sayings of Jesus. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. What does it profit a person to gain the whole world and lose their soul? Sell all your possessions and then follow. Our readings today identify three simple truths. One, we are called children of God, the least in the society at Jesus' time. In God's kingdom, the last shall be first. Two, we inherit the kingdom. We cannot acquire it. First and foremost, Jesus loved the man, and God is love. 1 John 4:8. Three simple words. God is love, and we are called to love one another. And then third, we're invited to follow Jesus, but we need to remove all the stumbling blocks that get in our way. For the rich man, it was his possessions. For the religious leaders at that time, it was their power and position. For the disciples, it was their false humility. What is it that's a stumbling block for you to fully follow? How do you need to be unburdened? I'd like you to hear the two verses prior to our first reading. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. These verses put our first reading into perspective. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs of Christ. As heirs, we are called to bring redemption, rescue, recovery, restoration, reclamation, and salvation to a world which so desperately needs it. For it says, creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. Reading more about Rich Mullins, I discovered he admired St. Francis of Assisi, who stripped himself of every stitch of rich clothing that his merchant father had given him. And then there's Mother Teresa, who gave up a comfortable life and religious order to help those abandoned to die on the streets of Calcutta. Neither of them had to do it alone, though. Others joined their vision and enriched the world. In the statement about giving all of your possessions to the poor, putting that into context, At the time, that was the Christian community. We all lived together and we shared everything. That's why it says if you lose all those things, you will gain all these things by being part of this great community. Our society does not work that way today. We are called to live that way out of an invitation, not out of compulsion. I'm grateful to be part of this community that supports and cares for one another, and as we heard, even God's creation. 60 tons taken out of the atmosphere. Amazing. And we are able to do this because of our tithes and our offerings, those who give. And how do you begin to give? We just talked about the rich man, so we had to have a stewardship story here. Mine started when the offering plate was passed, and my dad would give me a dollar, and I'd put it in the plate and pass on. Now, many of you are saying, but we don't pass the offering plate. No, I still see parents who give a dollar to their child, and I've seen them run down this aisle to put it in the offering basket in the back. That is a much more intentional act, or you can put it up here, than simply getting handed to me, drop it, and I keep doing my scribbling, my drawing that I was doing at the time. Then as I got older, we had chores. And if we did our daily chores, we checked it off, and we got a dollar for each day that we accomplished our chores. Whether or not I accomplished my chores, I was still instructed to give a dollar, whether I'd only accumulated $1 that week or all seven, to the church. And then as I got older and I had a little bit of my own money, I thought, well, when I open up my billfold to give, I'm going to try to give my largest denomination. You know, I have a 1 and a 5 in there. There's a 20. Okay, I'll give it the 20. And you learn how to give sacrificially. And then when I finally figured out my budget of what I was living on and all the bills that I owed, and then you had this money left over, I hope that is true, because there's lots of people. What's the simple rule of life? Spend less than you make. And hopefully you're in that situation where you have some left over. And so I learned how to tithe that amount. And then when I started working for a church and I got my first paycheck, I tithed the net of after the taxes were taken out and everything else was taken out, medical and so forth. And then when I became a pastor, I tithed the gross amount. This is how much the church gives me. This is how much I'm going to give 10% of that back to the church. And then when I came here at St. Luke's, because as an associate pastor, you don't see all the numbers. I saw all the numbers. I saw my package of what this congregation gives to me, and I'm grateful for that. And so I tithe that package. That includes the money that I get for pension and for medical and car allowance and so forth. First fruits, because it's not mine. It's God's. And I remember sitting at the kitchen table as a teenager. My dad was teaching me all about household finances. They had just gotten divorced. So now we had two households that the family was taking care of. We had less money. You've heard this story before, and he made me write out the checks to figure out the finances. And one of those checks every week was to the church. I'm like, that's a lot. He goes, that's our tithe. It's what God first gave us. When they died on December 31st of 2006, one of the first checks I wrote was their pledge for 2007 in full, because I knew that's what my father would have wanted. And then, looking at their entire estate, we took 10% of that and we put it into a scholarship fund so they can continue to give. My parents met as teachers at Chicago Teachers College. What a great way to remember your parents, and for our children and my sister's child, they get together and they choose who's going to receive the scholarship, and they hear what these kids have been doing. And that was a way for my parents to continue to speak to them, even at their death. Repeating my tagline for Ash Wednesday, this is hard to hear and even harder to live. I don't share this out of pride or to make you feel guilty or out of compulsion, but I do this out of encouragement. For when we challenge somebody, do we do it out of compulsion? Do we do it out of condemnation? Or I'm better than you? Or do we do it out of love? And that's what Jesus did with the rich man. He loved him first. And there are two financial workshops that we offer here at St. Luke's. I went through a financial workshop. I learned how to budget my money better. And the goal is to become wise with money to live a more generous life. And if you're interested, please put that on the back of your welcome card. If you're listening online, write me, rob@stlukesbloomington.org, and I will help you get connected. And there's another verse that many people probably know, but probably not by citation. Anybody? Acts 20:35b? Julie, I know you're looking. Jesus said, remembering the words of our Lord Jesus, for he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Let us go hearing Paul's words again. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. As the beloved community, let us set our minds on the divine things. Bless the children. Bless those in need. And bless one another. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
us together profess our common faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As disciples of Christ Jesus, called to love and serve all people, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Good teacher, your word is living and active in the church. By your Spirit, give us the will to leave behind those things that hold us back from following you and serving others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our treasure, help us cherish your gift of creation and be good stewards of all you provide. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hosts, you demand justice and hate oppression. Give the world honest leaders who speak the truth, uphold the rights of the poor, and work for the good of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, with boldness we pray for those who suffer adversity, addiction, alienation, or illness. Give them mercy and help in time of need. Today we lift up especially Mary Jean and Mick Thorsland and Nancy Hudson and those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Son of God, our great high priest, direct the spiritual life of this congregation that we continually seek you in prayer, praise, and service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We rejoice with the saints who live steadfastly in your love and now rest in your peace. We look to the day when we too will praise you face to face. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear our prayers, faithful God, and renew us by your Spirit, that we may joyfully love and serve you and one another, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
For those of you who are online, I encourage you to find something for your bread or your wine if you've not done so already, and join us at the table. Lord, we come to the table with many faults and failings in our lives. Things that we have done, things that we have left undone. Stumbling blocks that we put in front of ourselves or in front of others. We ask that you forgive us. That you remove all the barriers that we put between us and you, your children, and God's creation. Let us take a moment of silent confession. And Jesus' response to that confession, he looks at us and loves us. Just as he loved the disciples, those who he knew would desert him, those that he knew would deny him, and the one that he knew would betray him, he gave himself to them. And he gives himself to us in this meal of acceptance, forgiveness, and love. As he took bread on the night in which he was betrayed, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and after giving thanks, gave it all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we share the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. I invite those who are assisting to please come forward at this time. As you are invited up, you can stand or kneel at the altar rail. You'll be given a wafer. You can request a gluten-free wafer. And know that the darker cups are wine and the lighter cups are grape juice. This is the Lord's table. All are welcome to come and receive this gift. And for those of you who are online, take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have fed us at your banqueting table with bread and wine beyond compare, the very life of Christ for us. Send your Spirit with us now, that we may set the captives free, use our gifts to build up one another, and in everything reflect your glory revealed in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And as we journey through Lent, may we walk your path that leads to life and invite others in the way of salvation in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
With all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength, with all my heart, with all my soul. my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.